This is Brother Ron, and welcome to We All Be News Radio and TV, the news-free Dixie for the 21st century. Greetings. Welcome, family, to another wonderful, entertaining, edutainment edition of The Artivist Thinks. This is We All Be News-Free Dixie for the 21st century. Like I said, welcome, family, boys and girls, ladies and gents, scholars and laymen, to the sheeple and the people, to the wokish and the sleepish. This is your brother Ron with the word that you need to hear. Words create worlds. And like I said, knowledge is the currency of the universe. This is We All Be News Radio and TV. So yeah, it's been a long time. I know, family, been a long time, but there's so much to process right now. 2020 has got to be the greatest reality TV show of all time. Once again, 2020 has got to be the greatest reality TV show of all time. So much going on in the world of bread and circuses. This is definitely the land and the world of bread and circuses. Anything can happen in any given moment. Like I tell people all the time, 2020 could be a horror show, could be a comedy, but it's anything but boring. It's very, if not only exciting, anxiety filled for a lot of us. Right now, we're living in the pandemic era. I can't believe right now we're in the early days of October. Had a lot of late September and early October surprises, especially with this presidential selection coming up November 3rd. I don't know if we'll have a clear winner by the end of the night, November 3rd. Think about what happened 20 years ago with the hanging Chad in Florida and with Bush v. Gore and Supreme Court. All this stuff is 20 years later, we still dealing with the same old, same old. But I just want to weigh in. I know I'm late to the party when it comes to analyzing and giving my thoughts about the first presidential debate of the year, maybe the first and only, or maybe they could zoom it or live stream it or some type of way while he's quarantined. That's, you know, President Trump, Trump 45. He allegedly has COVID-19, which is interesting because early in the year he was touting and promoting the benefits of our hydrochloroquine. I think I'm saying it right. There were people say you could take, you know, it was a Detroit lawmaker, a sister Democrat. She said it's, her life was saved when Trump recommended that people start taking hydroxychloroquine. I think it's hydroxychloroquine. I don't know if I'm saying it right, but let's not worry about that. But what happened to that? You know, We All Be News had the opportunity to interview Dr. Stella Emmanuel, the beautiful sister from Africa, from Cameroon, who has a thriving practice down in Houston, Texas, who basically staked her career. She literally staked her career and name and recognition, you know, on the fact that she believed that hydroxychloroquine can cure COVID-19 along with zinc. You know, and saw vitamin C and stuff like that. And she was blackballed by the mainstream media. We All Be, through the helping of the one and only, a good friend of We All Be, Dr. Rennie Short, had the privilege of interviewing Dr. Stella Emmanuel. It is still up. I'm surprised. The video is called Truth Healer, think it's called Truth Healer, and it's still up on. Take a look. It's all online. We All Be TV on YouTube TV. Go to We All Be TV to check it out. The Truth Healer interview with Dr. Stella Emanuel, who has been promoting the benefits of hydroxychloroquine. I think I'm saying it right, folks. Hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine can save you from COVID-19 or even prevent COVID-19. But the president was talking about that and promoting it. Now, all of a sudden, you know, he's having a come to, I guess, Jesus moment with the COVID. I don't know if it's real or not, because, you know, this is like the one of the greatest reality TV stars of all time, Mr. Apprentice himself. So, I mean, he's a showman like no other. He's like a P.T. Barnum. He knows how to self-market and promote like no other. He's in rarefied air and rarefied form. And it's like he just, you know, he don't really give a, you know, about his welfare or other people. Just caution to the wind, according to the mainstream media. Like, he's driving around in a caravan in the circle of the Walter Reed National Medical Center. He's about to get checked out this Monday, October 5th. He's on his way back to the White House, from my understanding, to convalesce or maybe act the fool. Maybe that's his way of convalescing, to act the fool, to play the part of said court jester. Because Donald Trump is smarter than what people give him credit for. And my problem with the coverage of Donald Trump in the media is that they are too extreme in the negatives on Donald Trump. That's why I don't trust what they really got to say in their assessment of Donald Trump. And really is up to the people to do their research on said Donald Trump on anything that piques your interest, that catches your curiosity. So with that said, I believe that it's like so much stuff happening since last week debate. It's like it's another year altogether. But people ask me, well, Brother Ron, you think about the debates last week between Joe Biden and Donald Trump? And I said, Donald Trump won that debate. He won it hands down. I don't think people understand what debating is. I don't think people understand the history, how ugly American politics is. Go back to the beginning of the country, how ugly political campaigns can become. I mean, Andrew Jackson, his wife was targeted by a political campaign when he was running for president, I believe. He took it very, very personally. They targeted his wife. They made fun of Abraham Lincoln when he ran for president. They even questioned what he was in terms of his race. I mean, they made all types of cartoons exaggerating his a face that only a mother could love. So this is nothing new. But because a lot of us are very ahistorical, we don't study history. It's not promoted. We don't even understand who we are. We don't even understand what happened really last week. You know what I'm saying? It's like everything is so fast and furious with the information and the distractions. But no, I mean, what we saw last week was nothing new in American politics. That stuff been, that mudslinging always been around, but what's different is that technology can make it, you know, relay it faster than any time in history. All this stuff going on. Well, you look at, you know, this year marks the 60th anniversary of the first televised presidential debates between JFK, John F. Kennedy, and Richard Milhouse Nixon. You know, John Fitzgerald Kennedy and Richard Milhouse Nixon. The first presidential debate. Now, it's interesting because it proves my point about politics, popular politics, and voting. They're not about the issues. They're about feelings. Nothing but feelings. It's all about your feelings. Not about what you know. It's how you feel. And it comes down to this. For example, if you look at what happened back in 1960, you know, Kennedy, movie star looks, right? Very prominent family. Had a lot going for himself. Young, beautiful family. He has high hopes. And then you got Richard Milhouse Nixon, very ambitious, vice president, a very popular president, Dwight D. Eisenhower, very, very highly intelligent guy, you know. But if you look at the debate, you would say, well, if you had to pick a winner, you would say, okay, Kennedy won if you looked at it on TV. Because Kennedy had the good looks and, you know, that charm and charisma, you know, face made for the movies, right? And Nixon was battling him with a cold. I believe he was very sweaty, looked very uncomfortable because he was dealing with an illness. But if you listened on radio, you would have said Nixon won because he had a better sounding voice. you know, Kennedy is famous for that Bostonian Irish accent. He asks not what your contract can do for you, but what you can do for your contract, our dears. No, they say, don't say idea. They say our dears, you know, Cuba, Cuba, you know, and they say stuff like that, you know. But yeah, you listen to the radio, you would say, okay, Nixon won that because of his smoother delivery and stuff like that, articulation. But let's show you how it's really not about the issues. Voting is never about the issues. It never will be. Voting is a popularity contest. That's why they said you vote for your favorite American Idol, right? You know, survey says, you know, Family Feud, based on voting. When you vote, actually, it's like this a suggestion. It's like a survey. It's like, you know, the powers that be said, okay, who y'all want? The people, the sheeple. Who does the idiocracy want to be the commander in chief? Okay. But here we say, the Electoral College, the minority rules in voting. It's not the majority rules. The minority, the people who holds the power, who controls the franchise, they dictate who becomes the quote-unquote leader or puppet of the new world. Because presidents are not as powerful as people think they are. So, like, for example, 4 years ago, right, Hillary got more votes than Trump, but Trump is president because Electoral College matter. Your vote doesn't matter. The Electoral College vote matters, right? So I'm not saying, well, you shouldn't vote. I mean, maybe they do, maybe they don't. Donald Trump made a good point. You know, there might be some problems in voting. We might not know who's going to be president, the next president-elect or select on November 3rd because the issue with the mail-in ballot. It makes you wonder, you know, over the years, they have thrown away a lot of mail-in ballots because they were not filled out correctly. Or they might have got into their destination late. They didn't have the right postmark on it to be accepted. So there's a lot of things to come into play. Because even go back to 1960, you know, Kennedy barely won that selection. And really Nixon won, but they gave it to Kennedy because they had dead folks voting in Chicago. So you said my vote count, but you got dead folks who votes count too? They could vote in elections? Dead people in Chicago. So yeah, that swung it in favor for Kennedy, right? Richard Daley, Gangster Daley, the Daily Machine, and the Chicago Outfit, they helped swing Illinois in favor of Kennedy, just like in the West Virginia primaries for the Democratic nomination back in 1960. You know, Hubert Humphrey, you know, Judge Joe Brown, one of his favorite white boys, you know, Hubert Humphrey, who, by the way, did not pledge Alpha. He was made an honorary Alpha, right, back in January 9th, 1965. Y'all can look that up. Take a look. It's all online. I was like, a judge always tell me how he, you know, he pledged Alpha. He didn't really pledge Alpha. He was made an honorary, a life honorary. Remember, he didn't go through to the hazing. He didn't go through the line like that. I don't want y'all to think that Hubert Humphrey paid them John Brown dudes like that. But Judge loved the guy. And I love Judge Joe Brown. But yeah. But he actually spoke at the Alpha Convention, National Convention, back in 1948 before he became senator from Minnesota. That's Hubert Humphrey. But he posted that one, allegedly, the West Virginia primary, but, you know, Kennedy's father had them deep pockets and them deep mob ties, and they swam the primary in Kennedy's favor, and that set him on his path towards being nominated for president of the United States on behalf of the Democratic Party. Kind of like you look at Obama, you know, hope became real for a lot of people when he won the Iowa caucus. And, you know, I don't think they ever decided who won the Iowa caucus this year. To see the voting such a mess, even the probably we in 2020, and they still can't figure out who got the most votes. So I don't have no faith in the so-called what y'all think voting system is, and it's very emotional. But get back to the debate. Trump won with his body language, the way he carried himself. He was very confident. He was very assertive. It's kind of like if 50 Cent and Ja Rule had a versus battle. That's what that debate was. You know, I say, like, I look at Donald Trump being 50 Cent. Who's from Jamaica, Queens. Donald Trump is from Queens. I want to say he's from Jamaica, Queens at that. And Ja Rule, the cookie monster. Always on time, baby, baby. Holla, holla. He's from Queens, too. We got that bark. And I think I look at Ja Rule, like Joe Biden, me like Ja Rule being on the scene for a minute and not recognizing a new dog on the scene, a new cat on the scene, and Donald Trump. But Donald Trump really held his own. He brought them points home. What I like about what he did was he called Joe Biden off on his record. You know, People talking about Donald Trump has done so much damage in less than 47 months. But look at Joe Biden's career for 47 years, what he has done to the black family, not just him, but also the Democratic Party, how they have kept the black family perpetually on the plantation, on the cannon land. I call the Democratic Party like the cannon land, like from Django. Like Joe Biden's like Calvin Candy to me, or maybe Bill Clinton, but we are perpetually on the plantation, loyal to a party that don't give a damn about what happened to us. For whatever silly reason, we got as black people. And I wish we would grow up politically. I need for us as a people to be more mature when it comes to politics, because we're not mature. We're in an arrested development stage. But I like the fact that Donald Trump kept calling him out on his record. You know, he Crime Bill Joe, Sleepy Joe, Lynch Law Joe, Jim Crow Joe Biden, Dixie Crack Joe Biden. He just laid it into him, unrelenting, like a heavyweight champ should. Just kept on laying them blows on Joe Biden. And people talking about, well, he keep on interrupting him. But Joe Biden didn't have too much to say when it came to race, though. When it came to talk about black folks, Joe Biden didn't have too much to say. Donald Trump had a lot to say about black people. You know, he had said a lot. He made sure that we was included in the conversation. Whatever you think he may or may not feel about black people, he kept on bringing black Americans. When I talk about black, I'm talking about, well, y'all talking about the Adolphs, America, the descendants of slaves. When I'm talking about financial black America, he's talking about black Americans who built this country, their descendants. He kept on putting us back in the conversation. Because, you know, last week, he did, or the week, whatever, he did the platinum presentation, his economic plan for black America. And Joe Biden haven't talked about any economic plans for black America. Kamala Harris have not talked about any economic plans specifically for black Americans. Donald Trump has. So, I mean, it's interesting when I talk to our brothers and sisters in the street, they are all perplexed and they just discombobulated. They get like frothing at the mouth, foaming at the mouth about Donald Trump, about, you know, he's such an evil man, he's this and that. If he's such a tyrant, how come we still have social media that could criticize Donald Trump, that could ridicule Donald Trump? Why is it that the national mainstream press is allowed to ridicule, to make him look foolish, to clown Donald Trump? If Donald Trump was Stalin, there'll be none of that right now. There'll be no so-called freedom of the press or freedom of speech. The folks that are the tyrants and dictators are the folks in Silicon Valley who's suppressing freedom of expression and freedom of speech. All these platforms we give out intellectual property freely that make money off of mining our data that we get no change out of. We still waiting for a second stimulus check. You got billionaires becoming billions of dollars more richer in 2020. You got billionaires becoming richer and poor folks are becoming poorer. And the middle class is in a disappearing act. There's no in-between. It's all 2020 is about the year of extremes. So, now Donald Trump kept on bringing up Joe's track record, the crime bill, destruction of the black family. Because black people is about unity and solidarity. Unity and solidarity, one as the fist. System thrives out divide and conquer, separate as the fingers on the hands. And you got to think about it. This is not a broken system. It's a break-you system. So I applaud and commend Donald Trump on making sure that black people are not forgotten in this election cycle. Whereas Joe Biden, his mom, you know, like black is the disease for him. You say the word black, he'll die. Because, you know, he has dementia and he's demented. Allegedly. And if he didn't test positive for COVID-19, he definitely will test positive for racism and dementia. I'm sure of that. And the thing about it is, when I look at people's conversation, black folks, stop trying to figure out if Joe Biden is racist, if Trump is racist, all white people racist. If you look at it from that point of view, you look at racism as a system of privilege, not as an emotional state. You can understand where I'm coming from. White supremacy is not the system. White supremacy is a religion. White supremacy is not a system. White supremacy is a religion. See, you got black folks could be white supremacists. You know, follow a black person on church on Sunday. Who do they pray to? Is God white? Is Jesus white? You're a white supremacist. Can you believe in whiteness as a divine right to rule over your life? See, I don't confuse. See, you got a lot of people. They call themselves leaders. They just misleading people. They want you to feed it to something That doesn't have to be real, but if you believe, you make it real. If you make it, you believe in it, you can manifest your reality. You can alter your paradigms. What I'm saying is, stop saying that the system is white supremacy when white is not superior in nature. It's recessive. And it's a mythology. It's not real, but we make it real when we submit to it. When you tell your kids to obey a crooked cop or to submit to a disrespectful teacher, then you're destroying your kids' will to be who they need to be their authentic self, to their own self be true. It's the only way you can make your real contribution in the world. So what I'm saying is, this voting BS has not done a thing. I want somebody in the chat or in the discussion, you know, y'all talk on this video. Give me one concrete thing that voting has done for Black American folk, for foundational Black Americans, for American descendants of slaves, for Aboriginal Americans. What has the vote done? Name me one thing, not how it made you feel, and you feel that our ancestors, they didn't die for that. A lot of people that y'all say died for the vote, they were dying to save their Black, you know what. You know, Jimmy Lee Jackson, yeah, he's a civil rights martyr, right? He, like Dick, we always talk about Bobby Dick Gregory. I was talking about, well, you know, if it was for the death of Jimmie Lee Jackson, there'll be no 1965 Voting Rights Act. They didn't die for the right to vote. He died trying to protect his grandfather and his mother from getting beat up by an Alabama state trooper or Alabama state troopers. He died trying to protect his family from police brutality, which, by the way, in 2020, is very much still alive. And that was back in 1965 when Jimmie Lee Jackson got killed at the age of 26. By a state trooper that ended up allegedly killing another Black man next year and who died of old age recently. So he never really got any true justice. Like when they did bring him up on charges years later, I want to say he only served a couple of months in jail. They let him go. His name was James Bernard Fowler, if I'm not mistaken. I think his name was James Bernard Fowler. That's the state trooper that allegedly killed Jimmie Lee Jackson. But if you think about, okay, we're talking about white supremacy being Black folks' religion too. The four little girls who got killed in that church, 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham, Alabama. I went there several years before. It's right across the street from the Civil Rights Museum of Birmingham. And I went there. And you know, the explosion on that Sunday morning around Sunday school, right before Sunday services, was so powerful that destroyed a stained glass picture of a white Jesus in the church. And one of the first things the church did was replace that white Jesus. And it took some white folks from Wales, I believe they was white, from Wales across the pond to raise money to put a Black Jesus in the church. Because if you're going into the church, into the, you know, where they worship, if you look to your back up at the, you know, at the top, at the back of the church, you'll see a stained glass of a Black Jesus. But it took white folks to put a Black Jesus in a Black church after their church being exploded by a Klansman or the Ku Klux Klan in Birmingham, not Birmingham, but Birmingham, Alabama. And by the way, Condoleezza Rice and Angela Davis were friends, were childhood friends, or connected to the four little girls. They got killed. And shout out to Sister Sarah Rudolph Collins, the only lone survivor. And she suffered permanent eye damage, but she still lives in Alabama. She's forgotten about sister because she survived. Her sister got killed in the blast, but she survived. The only lone survivor, Sarah Rudolph Collins. Take a look. She's still online. She's doing fine. But yeah. But Trump talked about his rack. He talked about his son's connection to Moscow. You know, the Ukraine thing was really more about Biden people than it was about Trump. You know, Joe Biden, as sitting vice president, allegedly threatened, I believe, the prime minister of the Ukraine, saying that he would withhold billions of dollars of aid from the U.S. if he didn't do what he wanted him to do, which is to lay off his son's business dealing with a Ukrainian company. Yeah, y'all try to conflate that with Trump. And the thing about it is, I mean, I talked to a brother yesterday. He would say, well, Trump filed for bankruptcy. He didn't file for personal bankruptcy. He filed for, like, business protection bankruptcy. You know, like he said in the debate 4 years ago, his family never went poor or starved, you know, when he was running the Trump organization. He just did. He just played the game. He told us 4 years ago that the game is rigged. He never said that the game was not rigged in his favor. The reason why he could say that, because he's a boss player. He understand this man bankrupted a casino and still got paid. To let you know, he know how to make this thing go, right? You know, and y'all talking about Trump did all this damage. Trump has not got us into one new war. That's a Democrat thing to get us to war or to elongate war. I mean, yeah, George W. Bush, he got us in. Them neocons got us into Iraq back in 2003. You think about Barack Obama, he promised to close Gitmo Bay back in 2009. And Gitmo Bay is still open 11 years later. He was known as the Brown Bomber and the Drone Ranger. He killed so many people with drones. That is ridiculous. I mean, it was some American people got killed. I mean, to make it simple, American father and son, I believe, they had a website criticizing the government. And they were blown up by drones overseas. So you doing all this extrajudicial stuff, not allowing people, even as American citizens, to have their day or due process in court. And that's crazy. So people trip me out. Like, you know, you look at cases now, what's going on. People talk about mob justice. And to be talking about, well, we don't want no mob justice. Breonna Taylor case, we don't want no mob justice. And people are so silly. Just parades with guns. That's why parades with guns, right? And because the thing about mob justice is mob justice never had to wait on a grand jury decision to carry out extrajudicial stuff. Mob justice in this country never had to wait on a grand jury's decision to find out if they're going to break the law and do what they want to do by taking the law into their own hands. That's lynch law. That's the American way. That's the national pastime of America. Black folks, we all are too familiar. All too familiar. Generational trauma. You know what I'm saying? We all got stories, I'm sure, of loved ones being lynched or going out to get some bread and never coming back home. That's all too real for reality for ADOS and FBA, Foundation of Black Americans and American Descendants of Slaves. But Trump, people say he was rude, he interrupted, but that's how Americans do. We're rude, we interrupt. You know, I talk to people, I try to have a conversation with people, especially like you date some women, you know, a woman will ask you, a person will ask you a question, woman, well, my dating situation, they'll ask you a question before you even answer and complete a sentence. They'll just start talking, cut you off, start talking about themselves. That's America. See, Trump is a mirror to America. He represents America's ideals and morals and stuff like that. I mean, yeah, y'all talk about Trump, but Trump is us. He represents America. And that's why I love about this time that you've seen things with an honest lens. Like 2020 is about clarity and seeing things as is, not as you want them to be, not as you like them to be, but as is. And this is what's going on. You are seeing things as is. The people out to my Bobby Dick Gregory talk about two Trumps. He said that Donald Trump was broke. But here's the thing that stuck with me when Bobby Dick Gregory talked about Donald Trump. He basically said, I don't fear Trump. I fear Trump's shadow. What's coming behind him? Right now, we are living in the aftermath of Trump. It's been a paradigm shift. It's been a glitch in the matrix. And it's like pandemonium. We don't really understand what we're seeing. It's like with the Trump thing. Is he really sick? Does he really have COVID-19? Well, I think it's interesting. Is that Trump was sent where? He's known, be known as Bethesda Naval Hospital. Now they call it the Walter Freeman National Medical. I mean, Walter Reed. I said Walter Freeman. What am I thinking about? Walter Reed National Medical Center. But back in the day, he used to be known as Bethesda Naval Hospital. Now they had a Walter Reed Hospital, a general hospital in D.C. Now I made a social media post saying that better Walter Reed than Bethesda Naval, because that's where, you know, James Forrestal, the first Secretary of Defense, that's where Senator Joseph McCarthy, who led the McCarthyism, Red Scare things of the 50s, that's where France Fanon, you know, black thought leader, you know, Frantz Fanon, the great writer, philosopher. That's where they met their fate. That's where they died. James Forrestal, Senator Joseph McCarthy, and Frantz Fanon all died questionable deaths at Bethesda Naval Hospital. That's also where they performed a JFK suspect autopsy. When they wouldn't let the doctors in Parkland perform an autopsy, Secret Service would not allow the doctors to perform an autopsy. That's against the law in Texas. When Kennedy got killed in Texas, he supposed to have his autopsy done in Dallas County. But in order to control the narrative, whatever, he was dead. So what was the rush to get back to D.C.? If the man is dead, let the people do their job. But, you know, ain't about the official story's official cover, right? Because even in the limousine that Kennedy rode in, they quickly cleaned that limousine, reupholstered the limousine. I mean, like, they just fixed it. I mean, they just contaminated the scene of the crime, November 22nd, 1963. So Kennedy's body was no exception. They violated his right for a righteous autopsy to be done so we know what really happened, where the bullet actually came from. They sent his body to Bethesda Naval Hospital, and they did that botched autopsy with suspect photographs. So that hospital was actually dedicated by Franklin Roosevelt back in 1940, who was once, I think he was assistant U.S. Secretary of Navy, before he became, you know, eventually becoming president. They had Franklin Roosevelt, the cousin of Teddy Roosevelt, but he died a suspect death back in 1945, April 12, 1945, in Warm Springs, where he used to vacation. He was sitting, allegedly, for his portrait to be painted, and he died while the portrait. Now, you hear several stories that he was poisoned, that he was shot, that the woman who was painting his portrait was a spy for the Soviet Union or something like that. And I also read somewhere where Joseph Stalin, the leader of the Soviet Union, told one of Franklin Roosevelt's children, his son, that his father was murdered. And I remember reading somewhere in passing where someone like Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois, the foremost black intellectual of the 20th century, if not all time, talked about how they killed Roosevelt. They got rid of Roosevelt. So even back then, I mean, they're getting rid of presidents under suspect circumstances. But getting back to Bethesda Naval Hospitals, now it's under the Walter Reed National Medical Center tag. They closed Walter Reed General Hospital in 2011. Walter Reed General Hospital in D.C. proper opened in 1909 and closed down in 2011. So when I said that, I didn't know that when I wrote the post, that they referred to Bethesda Naval Hospital now as the Walter Reed National Medical Center. I didn't know the Walter Reed General Hospital was closed when I wrote the post, but I just left it up there just because. But yeah, but you know, they sent Trump there. So when I thought about, he went to Bethesda Naval, are they trying to eliminate and neutralize Trump by sending him there? Were they sending to kill prominent men and call it natural causes or suicide? They gonna send him where they sent James Forrestal flying out the 16th floor window and they said it was a suicide? Were they send Senator Joseph McCarthy for a routine? He had a knee issue. Then they say he ended up dying of a hepatitis C or cirrhosis of the liver. Or Frantz Fanon, the famous, you know, Pan-African thinker and philosopher. They sent him there and he let you die, I think, from leukemia or cancer back in 61. But it's interesting. Yeah, I'm gonna say, well, like I said on social media, better Donald Trump went to Walter Reed than Bethesda Naval. Remember James Forrestal, Senator Joe McCarthy, and Frantz Fanon all died crazy suspect deaths there. Triple X Files, right? But I didn't know Walter Reed has been closed since, the General Hospital has been closed since 2011. I'll tell you another thing, you know, the Reagan assassination, the attempted assassination of Reagan back in 1981. When he was allegedly shot by the guy whose family was real close to the Bush family. And yeah, I'll let y'all look all that up. But the plan, from my understanding, was originally I had John Judge, the great John Judge, the late great John Judge, conspiracy theorist, Cynthia McKinney, aide, and just an overall good human being, and just a good dude. He passed away several years ago. But he was on my show a couple of times. And he talked about the Reagan assassination attempt and how the plan was to get him to Naval Bethesda Hospital, or Naval Hospital in Bethesda, Maryland, so they could finish him off. But for whatever reason, somebody had the idea, George Washington Hospital is closer. So they end up taking Reagan to George Washington Hospital, where they basically saved his life. But had he went to Bethesda Naval, he probably would have been dead back in 81. Would have been no two-term president, let alone a first term, full first term. So that's interesting how this stuff worked, you know. But you can look all that up. Even if I talked about Roosevelt earlier, they said they killed them, right, allegedly, back in 1945, April 12th, down in Georgia. You also have the early alleged attempt on Roosevelt's life in Miami. I want to say back in 33, when he got elected first. He was down in Miami, you know, greeting the people. And this Italian immigrant named Giuseppe Zangara got on top of a chair or something and shot at his motorcade, shot at the car that Franklin Roosevelt was sitting up and waving to the crowd. Instead of hitting Roosevelt, he hit Anton Cermak, the mayor of Chicago. He ended up dying from his wounds days later, and they gave Giuseppe Zangara the chair. Now, people assumed for many years that the assassination attempt was directed towards Roosevelt, but now people say, well, you know, I think Anton Cermak was the actual target. It was made look like they were trying to get Roosevelt because Anton Cermak became a very powerful politician in Chicago. Basically, he wanted to take over organized crime in Chicago. He wanted to run the crime in Chicago as mayor. So some of his goons went to Frank Nitti's business place and shot him point blank, and miraculously he survived. And so he got paid back by getting Anton Cermak. At least that's how, what some of the other people would say about that story, about what really happened with that first assassination attempt on Roosevelt. But I heard stories that they said Roosevelt was slowly poisoned. He had folks in his inner circle that died of similar causes to Roosevelt, supposedly. But y'all can research all that. I'm just putting that stuff out there. But with Trump, you know, I heard he was going to Bethesda Naval on October the 2nd of this year, which is also the 220th birthday of the one and only Nat Turner, the revolutionary eternal Nat Turner. I thought, man, they're going to try to finish Trump out. Then you see how he's driving around the motorcade or whatnot, and the Secret Service is complaining about him driving around the motorcade. And what people got to understand, Trump is like JFK in a way. I'm going to tell you why. First of all, both JFK, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, and Donald Trump, they're both Geminis. JFK was born May 29th, 1917. Donald Trump was born June 14th, 1946. Both Geminis. You know, Donald Trump, a couple years ago, 3 years ago, tried to open up a large number of files on JFK. He made that available to the public. And also, like JFK, Donald Trump has a very cold, not that warm of a relationship with U.S. intelligence apparatus, with the U.S. intelligence complex. No, JFK had a great distrust or mistrust of the CIA. He wanted to scatter the CIA into 1,000 winds, right? I mean, he wanted to scatter the CIA into 1,000 pieces into the wind, something like that. And so he would know he fired the top people of the CIA, Dulles and Cable. Then Charles Cable, or Cabal, how do you say his name? So he fired two of the top CIA guys before he got killed. He didn't trust the CIA. He blamed them for the Bays of Pigs fiasco. They blamed him for the Bays of Pigs fiasco. No, when they tried to take back Cuba, and they tried to blame Kennedy for not providing the proper air support for the CIA and the Cuban nationals, the expatriates, to take back Cuba. And also, his daddy made a devil deal with the mob. That's how he got into office, JFK, of course. Like, you know, the mob helped him get into office. They gave him Chicago, Illinois, West Virginia, other things. But Donald Trump, you know, look how they use intelligence to try to take out Donald Trump with this so-called Russiagate. And, you know, the Mueller report and all that stuff. Donald Trump was allegedly spied on as an American citizen while he was running for office, the highest office in the land. So his human rights was violated. And also Donald Trump, like JFK, is not trying to get us involved in any wars. He's not trying to escalate our involvements in wars. So people kind of call Donald Trump a monster and warmonger. I don't, how is he a warmonger when he's trying to make peace with North Korea? He's trying to do business with our people that are so-called enemies. Where has Donald Trump got us involved in some major foreign war? He has not escalated our involvement in current foreign wars we've been entangled in for years now. You know, the war on terror is almost 20 years old now. September 11th, we'll have its 20th anniversary next year in 2021. I can't believe it's been almost 20 years since September 11th happened. That's my generation's Pearl Harbor, right? So he's trying to bring back manufacturing jobs, the same jobs that the Democrats, Joe Biden Democrats, and Bill Clinton's administration sent overseas through NAFTA. He's trying to bring those manufacturing jobs back. He is trying to make American work again. If he can't make it great, he can make us work again. Make America work again. That's what he's trying to do, far as I can see. So, and also, as we now know, now, just like JFK, Donald Trump is not well liked by his Secret Service. If you go by mainstream media and fake news, what they put out about the Secret Service, like they getting their lives jeopardized by riding around in the clown car with Trump, and they saying that, you know, he just being reckless. No, there's nothing they said by JFK that he was reckless, right? You know, why would he go to a place like Dallas where he's not that loved, where he's hated, and ride around in an open car with no type of bubble on top, at the Pope Mobile, just open convertible top through some high rises, through skyscrapers. That's a no-no. But he wasn't responsible for his security detail. That's Secret Service, who partied the night before at strip clubs getting drunk and high. You know, got a friend, God bless him, he's going through a tough time. The great Abraham Bolden, who's trying to get his name exonerated. Spanish American hero. He was the first Black Secret Service man to serve on a presidential detail. He was hand selected by President Kennedy in Chicago. While he was on his way to the restroom, President Kennedy saw him because they positioned Abraham Bolden in the basement of this hotel by the restroom. I guess out of sight, out of mind. They didn't want him to be acknowledged by anybody, but just so happened Kennedy had to use the restroom and he saw Mr. Bolden. And he was impressed by him. And he, you know, he wanted to say, I want you to serve on my presidential detail. But, and Mr. Bolden talks about this in his book, Echo from Daily Plaza. These his memoirs. Y'all should read it. It's on Amazon. Y'all should read his memoirs, Echo from Daily Plaza, where he talked about how he had to eventually resign from the presidential detail because of this, the racism and all the bigotry of the Secret Service men. A lot of these Secret Service men were from the South. They didn't believe in integration. They were sons of Jim Crow, of Dixie. They didn't want no Black man to be in a certain position. He talked about in the book how they have hangman nooses near his desk and stuff like that. But he told the president and told his brother Bobby, hey, I got to go. Let me go back to Chicago and work in the Department of Treasury. I think the Secret Service was out of the Department of Treasury at that time. I don't know how it works now. But, you know, he had a high conviction rate. He was known for breaking up a lot of forgery rings, like money, you know, people are forging money forgeries. Abraham Bolden had he was like the Michael Jordan of Treasury agents of Secret Service men. And also, he helped stop the potential assassination of President Kennedy at the Army-Navy game in Chicago. He got a hold of information about Cuban nationals moving in Chicago heavily with all type of weaponry. So he contacted his superiors. They let Bobby Kennedy know, who was the attorney general at the time, the top cop in the land. And he told his brother, you cannot go to Chicago. There's been a national security threat on your life. So he avoided going to Chicago for the Army-Navy game. They tried to get him in Miami, but they got him eventually in Dallas, November 22nd, 1963. And it definitely was an inside job because Abraham Bolden was on his way to testify before the Warren Commission. But he was arrested on trump up charges of running a forgery ring, you know, printing fake money. So they set him up. Now, this man had almost 100% conviction rate. And the folks he helped sit to jail became his prison mates in Leavenworth. They were trying to kill him in jail, right? He spent several years in prison for something he did not do because he wanted to do the right thing and testify about the lack of care and concern for President Kennedy's life among the Secret Service. Y'all got to remember, in the aftermath of what happened to Kennedy, there was serious talks about eliminating the Secret Service for failing to protect the president. The Secret Service came into play. Who had the first Secret Service detail? Who helped create the Secret Service? Y'all take a guess. Let me tell y'all, Abraham Lincoln. What happened to Abraham Lincoln? Much like Kennedy, he got shot in the head in public to make a point. So they're thinking about really getting rid of the Secret Service. And Abraham Bolden was going to be called because he warned his superiors that the president's life was in danger. He said that the Secret Service man that he served with did not have any, you know, respect for the president. They thought that he was too infatuated with black people. Y'all know the words they be using, you know. So they failed the president ultimately. So, you know, they said, okay, we're not going to take the fall for this. We're going to send this boy Abraham Bolden in jail. That's what they did. So he served several years in jail. He survived some type of way, many death threats and attempts on his life. And now he's an elder statesman trying to get the Trump administration to exonerate him or to pardon him. And I'm saying pardon loosely because he didn't do anything wrong but do his job, and he got punished for doing his job. But the reason why I shout him out too, because keep him in your thoughts and prayers, because he just lost his son to brain cancer. He just lost his beautiful daughter to recurring cancer, all in this year, 2020. He lost his son in August, on August 22nd. He just lost his daughter last week. She was too young, 63 years young, beautiful family, good man. Wish him well. Just send thoughts and prayers his way. We had a chance to interview him twice. We interviewed him about the Kennedy assassination around his birthday, on Mr. Bolden's birthday. He's born in January. So that was the first time we talked to him. This about almost, what was that, 9 years ago? And it went viral because after we did that 9 years ago, other folks started interviewing him about, you know, the Kennedy situation, about his amazing life. And we also did another interview with him maybe 6 years ago. But it's my hope that we could meet in person and get him back on the show. But he's going through a tough time, y'all. And he just recently got vision returned back to his right eye. He lost vision in his right eye several weeks ago. He had successful surgery, but only to see him losing his family this way in a year like this is unfortunate. Because 2020 was one of them years that people are dying because the year is so extreme. Like, normally people wouldn't die like this if the year wasn't what it was. This is my true belief. Whether it be young and old, whatever. So, yeah. So I say all that. I know I'm like, you're wrong. You're all over the place. But you see my point, the JFK and Donald Trump thing. You know, it's kind of weird. There's other people out there trying to get Trump. And I don't know if he's really sick or is it a precaution. We don't really know. The world's a stage, right? Anything could be planned. It's a big Hollywood production. Donald Trump's a reality TV show star. Look at the movie Wag the Dog that came out, what, 22 years ago? Talk about how this Hollywood producer was hired by White House aides to create a fake war to distract the American public from the sex scandal. A sex scandal involving a president. Sounds familiar? You know, so it is interesting to ponder. But with that debate, Biden, you know, they talk about the Proud Boys, right? They wanted Donald Trump to denounce, disavow, disown the Proud Boys. And to his credit, Donald Trump has wrote strong language denouncing, and I think, Antifa and the Ku Klux Klan. You gotta remember, Donald Trump's father allegedly was a Klansman back in the day from Queens. There's a New York Times article floating around from 1927, from June 1927, that talks about a Fred Trump from Queens being arrested because he was getting into a fight with the police during the Klan parade, right? Ku Klux Klan was very big back in the 20s. I mean, they had a very strong following in the 20s at this second, you know, incarnation. They started 1915, where? Stone Mountain, Georgia. So one of the biggest Klan states, of course, was Indiana, where you had everybody, state government, every level of government in the Klan, mayors, governor, senators, all that stuff. But anyway, yeah, his father allegedly was a Klansman from Queens. And Donald Trump said he had no knowledge of his father being a Klansman. But the sins of the father, you know, whatever. But Donald Trump, to me, is not, I don't think he really goes after black people the way black people think he goes after black people. I think Joe Biden, I know Joe Biden, I know Joe Biden has done more damage to the black family than Donald Trump. You talk about some housing discrimination back in the day, but look what Joe Biden's party has successfully done to disenfranchise the black family and the black vote. The crime bill. This is an albatross around his legacy. Joe Biden, at this point, should not even be a legitimate, you know, presidential candidate. The only reason he's legitimate because black folks made him legitimate. Because Barack Obama, the half breed, whatever you want to call him, the mulatto, made him legitimate. If Barack Obama never made Joe Biden his president, he'll be an afterthought. He'll be forgotten about. He'll just be withering away in a corner somewhere in hospice care or something. I don't know. But he wouldn't be where he at now. Just like Barack Obama legitimized Donald Trump. He legitimized Donald Trump when he showed that long-form birth certificate, if it's real or not, but he, you know, bowed down and submitted to the birther movement. And that's really what made Donald Trump rise to prominence, and he joked on Donald Trump during that White House Correspondents' Dinner. And that really motivated Donald Trump to be president. So the only people that Barack Obama could get elected is himself and Donald Trump. And Barack Obama is responsible for the rise of both Donald Trump and Joe Biden. So you think about what I'm saying. And one thing, like, you know, they wanted Donald Trump to, you know, with the Proud Boys, we said stand back and stand by, or stand down and stand by. I tell you, like I told a brother the other day, every successful politician in history has a goon squad. They are necessary evil. Like I told a brother, the reason why Mega Evers' brother Charles was able to live to be almost 98 years old is because, like he told me, he believed in the three G's: God, guns, and goons. You got to have a crew that got your back. You know, when they're trying to overthrow the government, you need some folks in the streets that got your back. You need your minuteman, your militia. So the Proud Boys and people like that, this is Donald Trump's minuteman, his militia, his backup crew. When the government trying to overthrow you, when they say, oh, Donald Trump, it's November 4th, or it's January this, we want you to get out of here, even though we got no clear result on who won on November 3rd, we want you. Now, oh, wait a minute, you can force me out. You know, they're going to try to decide it in the courts. They might have to decide it in the streets. But I'm thinking the black people, this ain't our fight. Even if you think about what I'm saying, people say, well, Donald Trump's Hitler. Okay. I don't believe he's Hitler, but let's just say he is Hitler, right? Who did Hitler have to help get him in power and keep him in power? He had the brown shirts, right? The SAs, the brown shirts. And who wore the brown shirts? Bunch of homicidal homosexuals. They were murderous homosexuals, right? And Hitler eventually got rid of them. You know, Google the Knights of the Long Knives. He got rid of his brown shirts. So maybe the Proud Boys are Hitler's, Trump's brown shirts, right? And what's interesting, you say that because they talk about on how online the Proud Boys hashtag has become a LGBTQ shout out. You know, white gay males are doing hashtag Proud Boys on their social media. So isn't it interesting that if these Donald Trump Proud Boys are like what the brown shirts were to Hitler, maybe there's something to that. You know, it's just interesting. But my thing is, why are black people concerned when we always had white terrorists in this country? We always had white terrorists hiding in law enforcement. We always had that. There's not no new phenomenon or, you know, system. This system protects white terrorism. You know, extrajudicial BS and mob justice is America's national pastime, not baseball. America's very violent. Like Dr. King said, the greatest purveyor of violence on the planet is my own government. But these times we live in, you know, I've been seeing the number 9 everywhere recently, right? You know, you think about what Dick Rigger talking about 4 years ago, that Donald Trump was going to be the last president, and people laughed because people assumed that we had a election, but it really was a selection because the person with the most votes didn't win 4 years ago. They decided they won't stay with Donald Trump. So it was selection. It was no election. Like Dick Ricker said, there was no election. And he said Donald Trump will be the last president. People laughed about that. And the way things are looking, and when he left, he got COVID, and his whole cabinet got COVID, and no, Joe Biden's like he see now. I don't know what's going on. The world is losing its mind. So there may not be no election or selection on November 3rd. The way things are going, the way the infrastructure is just fluctuating right now, you know. So you think about all that. Donald Trump is the 45th president. Four plus five is what? Nine. Nine is the number of completion, the end of cycles. So you have that. Nine's been everywhere. I've been seeing nines everywhere. Like, for example, the great baseball player, Bob Gibson, he just passed away. He was 84 years old, but his number he wore during his playing days was 45. Four plus five is what? It's nine. Okay? It's nine. Then another St. Louis Cardinals great. Man, we just losing these people, man. Lou Brock. These guys were great. Not only just great black athletes, but just phenomenal phenomenal baseball players. He died. That was Bob Gibson's teammate with the St. Louis Cardinals back in the day when they won on two championships. He passed away, and he was 81. Eight plus one is what? It's nine. Yeah, think about, you know, the Super Bowl winners right now. Kansas City Chiefs, they played with the Baltimore Ravens. They won that game this year, this football season, what, 34-20? 34 plus 20 is 54. They were the winners of Super Bowl 54. 5 plus 4 is what, 9. Nines are everywhere, folks. We are at the end of something and the beginning of something else. One door closes, another one opens, right? So we're at the paradigm shift. So I just want people to be aware of that. And I hope I said something that could be of use. I mean, think about, okay, Joe Biden. It is weird talking to our people. Y'all, I ain't gonna say y'all, but a lot of y'all think it's okay that Joe Biden did what he did to black people for 47 years, or did nothing for black folks and did this stuff to black people. His mentors were James Eastland, John Stennis, Strom Thurmond, Robert Byrd. These guys were all races of the first order. They believe in the religion of white supremacy, and Joe Biden was mentored and nurtured by these guys, and nobody's telling him to denounce or disavow or disown any of those guys. You know, he spoke very highly. I think he spoke at did a eulogy at Strom Thurmond's funeral, right? So I mean, this guy has no bones about hanging around with the white supremacists. He makes no qualms about it. You know, he did the stuff he talked about, the hateful stuff he said at the beginning of his career, but he didn't want his kids to go to school in the jungle with animals and stuff like that. And you know who he's talking about. Then to tell Charlamagne the guy, I think Charlamagne the guy should win a Pulitzer on the interview he did. He kind of Forrest Gump his way through that, you know, but he exposed Biden. And I think that opened some black folks' eyes about Biden and the Democrat Party. He said, when you ain't black, if you don't vote Democrat. I said, I guess if you don't support your own oppressing and suppressing, if you don't support white zaddy or support your white master, then you're not black enough. So in essence, I guess, you know, a lot of us believe in the religion of white supremacy, us black folks, right? We vote for these people. I hear people say, well, no, we'll hold them accountable when they get in office. I said, you should have held them accountable before they ever, you know, look, I don't understand our logic. There's no logic when it comes to black folks in politics. We're not mature enough to do the political thing that's going to benefit our people as a group. Maybe as individuals, but as a group, we are suffering right now because we have a lack of states people. Like, we don't have no statesmen or stateswomen that can eloquently articulate what's going on with us as black people. They could put like what Frederick Douglass said, power concedes nothing without demand. We don't have that strong base like that. I mean, we have a lot of people talking on social media. I talk on social media. A lot of us talk on social media. We talk. We talk about BS. You know, we talk about Meg Thee Stallion. We talk about LeBron James. We talk about sports. We talk about celebrity news. We talk about this BS, BS, BS. We're not talking about solutions. We're not talking about a lot of things. And we're not doing a lot of things we can do off the camera where eyes can't see because everybody wants credit for something. Everybody won't be seen and acknowledged. But a lot of the best and most important moves I made where there's no social media going on, where there's no live streaming going on. This is a time to be reflecting, to think, to read books, to form clubs, book clubs, gun clubs. This is a time that our most important aspects right now should be focused at the local level, not trying to have conferences and conventions and leave with nothing to show for the gathering. Now is the time to go deep within ourselves to find out what we really made of and to do what needs to be done, that we know needs to be done, and the sacrifices that we know need to be made. But yeah, Donald Trump won that debate. I'm gonna keep on saying Donald Trump won the debate. He made his point. People, I'm gonna tell y'all this. If they allow the selection to go ahead, Donald Trump will win in a landslide. He will win in a landslide. And if he don't win in a landslide, that means they cheated. And it will be contested. Donald Trump will not go quietly into the night. And he got his folks, well, on standby. So I will also tell black people, my people, if you're going to sit one out, this will be the one to sit out. And because we were still fighting the Civil War, because I don't understand the people who decide what is the most important thing to black people in this period is not black people. I don't care about no Confederate statues. I don't care about no flags. I don't care about a lot of stuff that people deem important and part of Black Lives Matter. I don't care about a lot of this stuff. If we are not making moves for our interests first, then we are not making moves. We're just going in circles. I mean, y'all talking about peaceful protests and bloodless revolutions. I don't know what those are. Unless you're talking about play acting, unless you're talking about doing a Hollywood movie, I don't see how you're going to do a bloodless revolution or a peaceful protest. You're just going to take it, what they give it to you. You're just going, I'm going to suffer with dignity. I'm going to suffer. Just don't put it all the way in too much, master. Not too fast. Just be nice and slow. But I'm telling you, will they kill you fast and furious, nice and slow, or softly, or they kill you softly, they still killing you. No matter how fast or how long it is, you are still suffering until you do something that's going to benefit not only you, but elevate your people and not really care about what you call white folks. Y'all keep on, y'all come to me with stuff. Y'all say, well, what are they going to think? I can't worry about what people think no more. I'm in a point now, I can't worry about what y'all think about what I'm doing right now. I didn't even feel like doing this right now. I kept on putting it off. I be listening to y'all. I listen to a lot of people talk. But let me put my own thing on there. There's some things that I hear I like, but there's some things I don't think people are focusing on. They hitting on. But I think that we not do a better job of researching, becoming students of history, of figuring this thing out, because time's a wasting, y'all. And I think I said as much as I want to say right now about the debate. Trump won the debate. You know, people talking about etiquette. You know, I'm going to tell you something. Some of the most intelligent people of all time in the world now, they don't use big words. They curse a lot. They rude. They unrefined. They not everybody's cup of tea. They're very polarizing. So I know that I'm uncouth, unrefined. I'm not everybody's cup of tea. I use curse words. So what? And I'm not asking you. And I'm in the point now where these are bonuses. When I do stuff like this, there's a bonus. If I bring y'all some people y'all need to know about, which I am going to do, it's going to be a busy month. It's a bonus. It's like right now, I feel like a running back. A professional running back, where, you know, like a lot of times running back have a lot of wear and tear on them. You know, like you'd be lucky if a running back can last 5 years in the NFL, right? So yeah, I got new black media peers. They just now start doing this work, but I'm 40 years old. I've been doing this for at least 20 years of my life. I have actually dedicated 20 years of my life doing this. I dedicated half my existence doing what I'm doing, and then do it in this form. I've been doing it for 13 years. So I got a lot of wear and tear on me. I'm not, you know, all sprightly and all enthused about stuff. I try to be, but it's hard to be. And really, a lot of time, I'm by myself putting out these truths. It's lonely to tell the truth. It's lonely to really share what's on your mind. You know, rejection is real. Alienation is real. But yet people will admire you from afar. It's interesting. Like I said, I go to places. People know who I am. They recognize the voice, my big head, my distinctive headwear, a lot of things, my laugh. But, you know, It's funny how you can have an impact, but then you're like, man, I don't get that many subscribers on that many views, but people know the work. And not just like about the big names, y'all know about some of my work. It's impressive when I meet a person and they say, well, I remember you said this on your commentary, or I remember you talked about this book. I said, okay, so the stuff is effective. So with that said, I'm gonna stop rambling for now. Thank you all for spending time with your brother, Brother Ron. I'll do some more. I'm gonna have some more guests on here, but I just wanted to get this off my chest. It's been on my mind. Like I said, I don't believe everything I see or read from the tell lies vision. It's propaganda, it's programming. You know, with Donald Trump, it's not important how you feel about him, it's what you know about Donald Trump, what you know about the issues. Challenge yourself on knowing instead of feeling and believing. No. If you can figure out how to know something, you got leverage that nobody else got, or a few people have. Because like I said, knowledge is the currency of the universe. So if you like the words from Brother Heard, I said words from Brother Heard, please spread the word. Subscribe. We All Be TV on YouTube. Support the movement. Cash App your support. Look on down on the scroll. $R2C2H2. That's $R2C2H2. You can Google Pay or PayPal your support at R2C2H2 at gmail.com. Once again, that's R2C2H2 at gmail.com. The Google Pay or PayPal your support, or your Venmo at R2C2H2 at R2C2H2. You can buy Art of His Art, R2C2H2.com. That's R2C2H2.com. Also, you can wear Art of His Art. You got this Nipsey Hussle, Nipsey the Great, Lionel Crenshaw. Go to our Teespring. Look below this video. If you're on YouTube, below this video description, there's a shelf of some of my latest and greatest creations on shirts that you can wear. Shirts, sweaters, and hoodies you can wear. And we're creating more stuff. The best is yet to come. So go to our Teespring, R2C2H2's place, to check that out. So thank you once again, family. In the words of the great Gelatin, we love you madly. Keep on producing and pushing. And please remember that Black power is unity and solidarity. We love y'all madly. Stay beyond category. And one more thing, family, before I let you go. Let's say that Joe Biden wins this election, right? Will he be really running things, or will he just be a sitting duck, maybe a puppet Trojan horse? Like maybe he'll serve longer than William Harrison. You know, William Harrison had the shortest tenure of any president in American history. I think he only served a month in the White House before he died. It's back in the 19th century. But it would be safe to say, you know, I think that's one of the reasons why Kamala took a VP nominee position, because she know that Joe Biden is not fit to complete a full term. But I also think that the power behind the throne would be Nancy Pelosi. Let's say Joe Biden had to step down, if he die in office, you know, Kamala would be the president. But really, Nancy Pelosi will have all the strings and should be pulling them. Oh, we'll see. It'll be interesting. These are exciting times to be living. But I have no fear. We just got to keep on doing what it's doing. And we all be in it to win it. We all be in it to win it. Thank you.
Hey, everybody, this is Brother Ron. I am asking you all to do me a big favor. Think about supporting the We All Be movement. Your donation is tax deductible. The We All Be Group Incorporated is a recognized 501c3. And I'm just asking you all because I want to keep on bringing y'all quality work through the way that I know how to do best. And I'm going to sing my praises and toot my horn. A lot of y'all would not help the Dick Gregory until Brother Ron brought him on the We All Be platform, until that Django review we did. Y'all seen another side of Judge Joe Brown, and Judge Joe Brown's message has been amplified. But it was We All Be that brought Judge Joe Brown to y'all back in 2014. And so many others. And we covered so many things. So help us out so we can help you all. Peace.